what Jesus said.
I came to tell you
what Jesus said.
I came to tell you
what Jesus said.
Said
repent of your sins and be baptized.
Oh,
repent of your sins and be baptized.
Amen. Good morning. Welcome to another service with us today at Liberty Temple Christian Church. This is the day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice together and be glad in it. What a blessing. February the 21st of 2021, the Lord has allowed us to be together one more time. And in spite of all what happened this previous week, that is a good thing that this day that we're here at this time and this moment, and we thank God for that. Again, we welcome all that have already logged in, praying that more will come, but at this time, we're going to go back to our praise team. They're going to lead us in a couple songs of praise and worship. And hey, then I'll come back with our word for today. Again, this is the day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice together and be glad in it. The fact that we're just here today.
Holy. This is the season for grace, for favor. This is my season to reap what I have sown. This is my season for grace, for favor, yes. This is my season to reap what I have sown. See, I have been perfect, but I sure been faithful. See, God got a purpose, and I know he's able. I've got a seed in the ground that is blessing, no more stressing. I've got a seed in the ground, now I know him. And it's showing
this is my season
for grace,
for favor.
Oh, yes, it is.
This is my season to reap what I have sown. This is the
season
for grace. For favor,
yes it is.
This is my season to reap what I have sown.
Let me tell you, I have been perfect, but I sure been faithful. You see, God got a purpose.
Hey.
And I know for myself that he's able. I've got a seed in the ground that he's blessing, no more stressing. I've got a seed in the ground. Now it's growing. And it's showing.
This is my
season
for grace, for favor.
Oh, yes it is.
This is my season to reap what I have sown. This is my season
for grace.
For favor.
Oh, yes it is.
This is my
season
to reap what I have sown.
Everything is working together for my good. Yes it is.
Everything is working. Together for my good. Everything is working.
It don't feel good sometimes.
Together,
but it's working
for my good.
Just hold on, you just hold on.
Everything is working.
It's working
together for my good.
It's working for my good, y'all.
Good.
for my good.
It's good.
It's good.
It's good.
It's good.
It's good.
It's good. It's working for my good.
It's good.
It's good.
Real good.
It's good.
It's working for my good.
It's working for my good.
Season for grace. This is a season to reap what I have sown. This is a season for grace, for favor, yes. This is a season to reap what I have.
Amen. What two great songs of praise and worship. Amen. We know glory to the Lamb. He deserves the highest for all that he has done for us and to encourage us, because we're always in a season. But the song encourages us that, you know, if we just sow good seeds, that we will have that season of grace, that season of favor, that we will reap from what we have sown. All I got to do is sow good in every season, and I'll be guaranteed at the Lord's timing, hey, we all going to have that season that we're going to reap from what we have sown, and I'm so thankful for that. What a great encouragement, even in the midst of a pandemic, even in the midst of tough times. If I just sow good, then I know for a fact, as the Bible has encouraged us, you know, that whatsoever man soweth, that shall they also reap. And you know, I believe what the word of God says. But the other side of it, if I sow bad, I also shall reap from that as well. But I have a guarantee that if we just sow good seeds, hey, we know we can just wait on God for that season. It will come. Thank God for that. What a great hope to have. We thank God again for allowing us to come together one more time. We're going to get ready to go into our word for today. Hey, you know, we're celebrating Black History Month this month. So for the next two Sundays, that's where my focus is going to be. I'm going to do a little two-part series today and next Sunday as we close out Black History Month. Amen, because it is so important. Amen, history is so important. You know, we don't know who we are if we don't know our history. So Black history for every Black person, every race should know their own history. It don't matter whether it's Black or whatever nationality, what we need to know who we are and where we come from. So important. So we thank God today. We're going to go right into our word for today. Get your Bibles. I want you to go with me to the book of Joshua, chapter 4. And I'm going to read verses 14 through 24. And our title for today is going to be The Power of Our Testimony. And the subtitle is going to be Stones of Remembrance. But the power of our testimony. Let's look at Joshua chapter four, starting at verse 14. It says, and it reads, on that day the Lord magnified Joshua in the sight of all of Israel, and they feared him as they feared Moses all the days of his life. And the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, command the priests that bear the ark of the testimony that they come up out of Jordan. Joshua therefore commanded the priests, saying, come you up out of Jordan. And it came to pass, when the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord were come up out of the midst of Jordan, and the soles of the priests' feet were lifted up unto dry land, that the waters of Jordan returned unto their place and flowed over all his banks as they did before. And the people came up out of Jordan on the 10th day of the first month and encamped in Gilgal in the east border of Jericho. And those 12 stones which they took out of Jordan did Joshua pitch in Gilgal. And he spake unto the children of Israel, saying, when your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean these stones? Then you shall let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry land, for the Lord your God dried up the waters of Jordan from before you until you were passed over as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea when he dried up from the Lord before us until we were gone over, that all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord that is mighty, that you might fear him, fear the Lord your God forever. Amen. From that reading, we want to use this again. Our title for the next two Sundays is going to be The Power of Our Testimony. And again, the subtitle is going to be The Stones of Remembrance. Now, let's establish a definition. When you think about testimony, in my mind, I think about it's my faith story. You know, it's my own personal story, my history, my journey, my relationship with God, my witness about what, you know, about, you know, the works of the Lord in my life, the things that have happened to me. It's all about where the Lord has brought us from, who God is to me, what God has done for me, and where God has brought me from. All of that encompasses around my testimony. Now, and I look at a testimony, a good testimony, always going to consist of two parts. It's our personal journey, but it also has to have a testimony of Jesus Christ mixed in with it. You know, how God has impacted my testimony. I'm telling you, you got a testimony, and God is not getting the credit for bringing you, for doing all what's happened good in it, then it's not a good testimony. It has to include God as well. Our testimony, it glorifies God. It encourages others. It strengthens us. You know, our test, it shows people how we came through, how we made it over, how we endured, how we was able to accomplish what we have accomplished in life. And through it all, we give God the glory out of all of it. As the one of the songs that were being sung to us today actually was talking about Romans 8 and 28. And it says, and we know. And that's just so important. You know, as a believer, we need to know this for a fact, that all things work together for the good to them that love God and to them that who are called according to his purpose. If we know that everything works together for the good, then whatever the things that I go through in my journey, in my story, in my life, in this season that I'm in, we know that no matter what, hey, if I'm a child of God, I know it was all is said and done, this too is going to work together for my good. Now, there's always a time test in everything. Everything has a process to it. So, you know, it's not, you know, it might take some time for it to work together, but if I be faithful and trust God through it, I believe for a fact that part of my testimony, well, you know what? God brought me through this particular situation. And when you're talking about Black History Month, that should be the testimony of every Black American. I don't know, from the very beginning of this country, even up to this very present day. What we got to understand is soul salvation was Jesus' number one priority when he came to earth. And salvation means the deliverance from the penalty of sin and death. Jesus did that on the cross. That was his number one goal. He was the Lamb of God that came to the earth to take away the sins of the world. And he did that. But in the midst of him doing all of that, there were also, he brought other salvation in other areas. God, Jesus was delivering people in so many ways. Look at the miracles. Look at all the healings and different things that he did. He is a deliverer. There's salvation in so many ways. A good scripture to encourage us in that is in the book of Luke, starting at chapter 14. It talks about here that there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and to recover the sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And he closed the book and he gave it again to the minister and sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your eyes. So salvation, deliverance, every deliverance that we have and ever need, Jesus brought it to earth with him that he can do. I know he can do for heaven, but while he was still on earth, he was yet still delivering. He was still opening ways. All of those, number one was the spiritual, but yet and still, he also had deliverances in many other ways for us as well. And this is what brings me back to here, Black History Month. Here, it remembers and it honors the African American testimony. You see, one thing we know about God is our expected end was not slavery. We might have gotten to this country, it started out in slavery, but that was not God's expected end. And I pulled it out of Jeremiah 29:11 when Jesus allowed his people to go into captivity then for 70 years, but yet still he told them that was not your expected end. As a matter of fact, he put it this way, "For thus saith the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good work toward you and cause you to return to this place. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." So is that right there, as a black person in this country today, we can rejoice there, you know, that our expected end was not slavery. Look where the Lord has brought us from, even to this point that we're in. None of us were born in slavery. But can you imagine those people that were brought in slavery and those that were born into that kind of environment? You know, for them to believe this took a lot of faith, but look where the Lord has brought us from as a people. We got a ways to go, but thank God we're not where we were in the past. So we can still rejoice about our testimony as well. We were another testimony of the hand of God delivering his people out of bondage and oppression. And that is exactly what he did. That is why we should celebrate where the Lord has brought us from. Our journey from slavery, 1619, to the civil rights in the late mid-50s and in the 60s, even to this present time, here in 2021. Our testimony cannot be truthfully told unless we first acknowledge the fact that it was the hand of God that delivered us. So no matter where we done come from and who God used in the midst of getting us to where we were, to where we are now, we gotta always, number one, give God the glory for it, even before we honor the people that God used to help deliver us. But yet, in fact, we got to give God the number one credit. And I want us to focus our attention also on Psalms 124. It says, "If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say," but I can also, I think I can take the liberty to say that, hey, now that the African-American people can't say the same thing. "If it had not been for the Lord on our side when men rose up against us, then they had swallowed us up quick when their wrath was kindled against us. Then the waters had overwhelmed us. The stream had gone over our soul. Then the proud waters had gone over our soul. Blessed be the Lord, who have not given us as prey to their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken and we are escaped." And verse 8 says, "Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth." That's why we need to give God the glory. Those different things that God delivered for in this particular verse here that David was quoting this psalm, they pretty much represent anything that we have to go through with. But through it all, he delivered us. And that should be the same. That's what Black History Month is about. We remember, we recognize the fact. We look at our testimony, we tell it, we share it. Look now, this whole month, we've been hearing so much about the accomplishments, where we've come from, the ups and downs of all our testimony, but yet it still, it brought us to the place we are right now. But the number one thing is we got to give God the glory. We got to give God the credit for it. If it had not been, if it had not been for the Lord on our side, where would we as a people be today? It's nothing that we've done on our own. It was only by the help of God. Even from the fact that Jesus, the number one salvation, our soul salvation, he saved us from sin, but he also delivered us from sinners. Anybody that want to put anyone in slavery is a sinner. I don't care how much they go to church or whatever they do. Anybody that want to oppress and bring injustice on another person, that is not the will of God. That is a person that is committing sin. And it don't matter whether white, it's sinners of all colors we've been delivered from. Some of our own problems was within our own people. But the good news is we got a ways to go. Hey, but God is still delivering us. He's brought us from a mighty long ways. I want to draw from Psalms 118 and 23, when it was talking about how, you know, that Jesus became the chief cornerstone, and the scripture says that this is the Lord's doing and it's marvelous in our eye. They reject it. Said, matter of fact, the chief cornerstone that the people rejected has now become the chief cornerstone. And it said, this is the Lord's doing and it is marvelous in our eyes. And guess what? When you look at us as a people, we are the Lord's doing, our deliverance. This is the Lord's doing, and it should be marvelous in the eyes of every black person. You know, you don't have to have, like I said last week, don't let other people define us. Be proud of who we are, who God created me. You know, embrace our journey. It's our heritage. It's our story. God did it. This is us. We should embrace it. Nobody should be more proud of our journey than us. But good thing about it, you need to know your journey, know your history. If we don't know our history, we really don't know who we are. So this is why we should celebrate. It is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. Black history is not only the African-American history, but it's part history of all American people. You got to understand, the African-American helped shape this country. We built it on, this country was built on the backs of black and African Americans, so we helped shape this nation. It's not in the American history books. We know that it's not written that way, but you know what? This is why we need Black History Month, that we can tell our story. We can let our story be known, not only to our own people, but to the whole world. No, they're not gonna go back and rewrite history books. You know, it is what it is. But that is no excuse why we as Black people cannot make sure that our story is known and told to our children. We gotta learn how to teach our story, but we gotta know our story that we can share our story with anyone else. I'm saying you're not gonna find a lot of this stuff in the American history book. But good news is this, the Bible has many examples and stories that remind us of how God feels about oppression and injustice and hatred. Trust me, look how much he pushes in the Bible to love your neighbor as yourself. I say this time and time again, the highest level of love is when you can love someone as yourself. And then we got to love our enemies, which is another issue to the Lord. But we know one thing about it. God always sides on the side of justice and righteousness. As a matter of fact, one of the Hebrew names they gave for him was Jehovah Tiskenu, and it means the Lord God our righteous. He's always on the side of justice and equality. It don't matter what the race is. If you're doing performing an injustice, inequality, or hatred, or superiority over another race of people, then there's no way that God's going to be on your side. You cannot turn back and quote Psalm 124 when you're doing evil toward God's people to say, if it had not been for the Lord. He is not on our side when we are oppressing his people. Scripture also encourages us to remember and forget not how God has always delivered the righteous, the innocent, which brings us to our text here in Joshua 4. God had come deal with it. Moses had just finished giving the book of Deuteronomy his discourse. They were lined up at the Jordan River getting ready to go into the promised land. Then you remember how the story goes where God called Moses up into Mount Nebo, and he died there, and they took a certain amount of time to mourn the death of Moses, and then they came to a time, there was time to go over into the promised land, and this, in the third chapter, God began to instruct Joshua on what to do, and he commanded him to set up 12 stones in remembrance of Israel's miraculous crossing of the Jordan River into the promised land. He was getting ready to do another miracle, but he wanted them to set up stones of remembrance. Matter of fact, he told him to take out 12 men, one each out of each tribe. And when the priest stepped into the Jordan River, the water is going to separate, and it's almost similar to what happened on the Red Sea. And he says, I want those 12 men to go out and each one to get a stone and to put it on his shoulder and take it across with them as we go into the promised land. And then we're going to build a memorial for them, 12 stones of remembrance that he had them to sit. The stones would stand as an everlasting memorial to testify to the future generations of the provision of God. In other words, to remember and forget not what the Lord has done here this day. And see, listen, our testimony, our story, our history, our heritage as Black people, that should be our stones of remembrance. The things that the Lord has brought us through, we should teach them to our children, that they will never forget who they are and where they came from, and to be proud of their heritage. Our testimony is the memorial stones of remembrance. It is the power to keep all generations connected. It is our story, it is our people, it is our history, it is our deliverance to where the Lord has brought us from. Now understand this, God did a lot for every race, but I'm talking about our story. February is Black History Month. So we're talking about our history, where the Lord has brought us from, and we should embrace it. Amen? We should tell it in this month. You know, you only get one month out of the year, and it's the shortest one, so we got to be diligent about it. We got to be about making sure not only our people, but the whole world know what our story is. Let them know that if it had not been for the Lord on our side, that we wouldn't be. But thank God that God was on our side. Amen? It is our story. We push this theme about connecting the generation. As Black people, nothing should connect us more as a people than our story. Number one, you know, we know that Jesus Christ is our Savior. He is, that's the connection for our salvation. But as a people, the story of where the Lord has brought us from and how we did it and some of the things we had to endure to get there, those are also a good way to connect the generation. The older we are, the more we are able to tell the generations that are in front of us. Understand, it's pushing important that we don't let our story, because the sad thing about it, you can go to any private elementary school now and mention certain names, Dr. King and some of the other ones. Some of these kids don't even know who they are. They're so far away from it, they don't know who. Yeah, I heard of him, but there are people that go further and further back, all the way back throughout our history. We should keep those things relevant before our, connect with every generation. But another thing, we should not just wait until Black History Month to talk about Black history. Make sure that we connect through our story as well. And there are three things that Black History Month will help us to do. Number one, it can help us remember to show honor. Number two, it helps us remember not to repeat the past wrongs. And the third thing, it helps us remember to inspire hope to all generations. We're not just celebrating this month just to be celebrated. I think it was 1924, 25, somewhere in there. I forget the man's name that started it, but that was a good thing that he did. That, you know, the Black people's story should be remembered. You know, our story has value to it. We are important. This country was shaped in so many ways and impacted so many ways by the history of the African American. So let's look at the first one, to show honor. It's a good thing to remember and honor the people, both Black and white, whose efforts and sacrifices have played important roles in the cause of Black freedom and equal rights. Now, if we don't study history, we would think the only ones that helped us during this journey were only Black people. There were many white people, and they're free into slavery and everything, even up to our civil rights movement, that helped us. There are some that gave their life, just like other Black people did, to help us along the way. They understood how God felt about, oppression and equality, and they helped us. They made sacrifices and played important roles to get us to where we are today. But look at this, as Black people, think about this. Black history has its own Hebrews 11, our own heroes of faith, and faith and courage that God has used throughout history. There are many people that gave great sacrifices and did things for us that we should remember, we should honor them, and we should never let their names be forgotten, because we know that God is our number one star in our journey, but we know also everyone else, they are what? They are the co-star. They are, they are the ones that God used to get us to where we are. Understand this, freedom has never been free. Our salvation, our soul was not free. Jesus had to die on the cross. He suffered, he endured some of the worst suffering ever has been for you and I, but also our social freedom. to get black people to where we are, many people have died. And there has been many, many days of suffering and hardship that has been sacrificed. Again, freedom has never been free. It caused many lives and much hardship. And to think about it, we're still dealing with some of the hardships of, you know, slavery and racism and oppression and all those things, even here in 2021. Every now and then, there's still some of our people are dying just because of, you know, inequality and injustice that's still being shown. So again, God has brought us a long ways, but we still have a ways to go. But I still believe that God is still delivering. Sometimes it's a process. It takes time. But by remembering and retelling their stories, we honor them and we show gratitude for their courage and their examples. These people can be stones of remembrance. That when we think of them, when we speak their name, when we talk about them, our minds should automatically run back to our story. And we can rejoice there and see where we are. Look where the Lord has brought us from today. These people, these events can be stones of remembrance. But not only can Black history can teach us to show honor, but it also can teach us don't repeat the past wrongs. I'm gonna tell you something about history. True history is retelling will always reveal the truth. It's gonna tell the good, the bad, and the ugly. And it don't matter who did the good, who did the bad, who did the ugly. True history will always tell the truth. And the sad thing about the country that we live in here, true American history is a mirror that most Americans don't want to look at and acknowledge. If we really told a 100% truth about this country from its birth to everything that's been done, again, it's not a history book that way. And a lot of people don't want to face the fact that the truth is nothing but a mirror. As the Bible says, it's just like the word of God, true history is a looking glass. You know, you look in and see yourself. You can't change history, but you can acknowledge the wrongs of history. Don't just go and pull out all the good out of history and claim that. But the wrongs and injustices and all that has happened in history, you want to deny and ignore them like they never happened. But history is always going to tell the truth, though. We don't have to tell the truth. History will tell the truth on us. And it's the same way, but that's why it's important that our story has to be told. The Bible's, but here's the thing about us as Black Americans. The Bible puts us in a tough position, you know, when you come talking about the rights and wrongs, all the oppressions, everything that has happened to us, because in Matthew 5:44, he tells us to love our enemies. You know, he said, yeah, put it like this. Let's go back to verse 43. It says, listen, you have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. You know, that would be a lot more easy to swallow what has happened to us as a people if this is the way Christ left it. But he says in verse 44, but I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he makes his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and send rain on the just and the unjust. This comes out of Jesus' mouth, but now let's take it one step further in Romans 12 chapter. Verse 19, dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thy enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink, for in doing so, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Now, that's a tough test. When you have been through what the Black America in this country has been through with, and as a matter of fact, it's still going through to a certain degree. It's not easy, but yet and still, he commands us to do those things. And we're gonna have to just what? You know, we just gonna have to stick with it. Think about this, if we murder a murderer, then we become a murderer, and then we're no better than they are. And that's not an easy thing to do when you've been through the suffering, the pain, and the things that we have as a people. You know, I tell you, the one thing that I don't need to do no more, I think I've been to my last, museums and all that shows, all we done been through as a people, because the last time I went to one, you know, it started stirring stuff up in me that need to stay dead. So, I mean, I don't want to see no more people, what they done did to us and stuff like that. I mean, some people's okay, but I don't, you know, because it stirs up some stuff in me that I think I need to leave right where they are. I don't want to go back. I'm going forward, but it's not easy. If you love or have any kind of compassion to see other people endure some of the atrocities that happened, I think between the Black America and the Jews that went through back with Hitler and all that, this is some of the worst crimes against humanity has ever been done. And then besides that, I have to love my enemies. God, Lord, you know, you took your thing to a higher level with that. But it's not impossible. But keep in mind, every person that is not our color was not our enemy. In America, all white people were not an enemy. It was just a certain number. Some of our enemies today are our own people. But if, again, we got to learn how to love our enemies. Jesus taught us a good example of how to love our enemies. Even if we're going to give him credit to bring us this far, then we also got to accept the accountability that we got to also obey what they tell us to do. It's a high test to what we've been through with, but you want to sow a good seed. Amen. If we want things to work together for our good, we still got to obey him, but we got to love, and we cannot go, you know, allow him to do the vengeance. He knows how, and we don't. Violence has never got us anywhere. Dr. Martin Luther King, that was his strength. You know, the civil rights were only won because of nonviolence. He understood what Jesus was just telling us to love our enemies and how to do. He didn't fight back with carnal weapons. He fought and won with spiritual weapons. It caused him suffering. Again, but hey, we were suffering anyway. It caused him persecution. We was already being persecuted. But ultimately, it cost him his death. But the civil rights bill was signed. Victory did. It did happen. It did work together for our good. But there's always been sacrifices made when it comes to the fight for freedom. Understand, history is important. Those who don't learn from the past are doomed to repeat it. Think about this for a thing. The number one murder total against Black people is Black on Black murders. Out of all in this time that we're going through right now, our biggest enemy when it comes to killing us and taking our own lives is our own race. We got to learn. Let us value us as a people. Just because other people don't mean we should not value ourselves. Think about this. Black lives matter to Black people too. And that should be our, and if we believe that, then we will value each other as brothers and sisters. And the last thing we need to do is to take each other's life. Don't repeat the same mistakes that were made by other people. Pick a good example to follow. Let us keep the things of the past that were good and leave those things which were not good. We don't want to go back to Egypt. We don't want to go back into oppression. I cannot be mad at an oppressor by oppressing somebody else. Then I become an oppressor myself. The third thing is we got to inspire hope. That is one of the best benefits of the Black History Month. When we talk about the story, when we see all these different things and hear about these people that have been so pivotal in our journey, it should inspire hope. Remember the movie Roots? The first thing that Kunta Kinte did when his daughter was born, he took her right from the mother, went outside and held her up. And he said to his daughter, "Behold, there's none, the only one that's greater than thee." He gave God the glory for her that she'll never be, her place is always under God. But he also began to tell his story. He told that child his history, who she was and where she come from, even though they had changed her name and all that. He made sure that she knew where she really come from. She knew it. And guess what? All his descendants down through that particular series did the same thing with their children as well. So we remember so that all generations will know and see our story as a memorial. As our story as a memorial remembrance. Just like those 12 stones that Joshua and them would put up to remember the fact what God was going to do that day, and we'll pick it up next week, and you'll see in that story, it says that the stones are still there to this very day, that we would never forget what the Lord has done. And we want our generations to remember those stones, but we also want them to be proud of who they are and where the Lord has brought them from. James Brown made a song a few years back. He says, he's I'm black and I'm proud. We should be black. We should be proud of our heritage, who we are. Don't devalue yourself because somebody else has devalued you. We're all made in the likeness and image of God. God looks at us as equal with any other. No one is superior because of their race or nationality. We are all God's creation, and he made us all in his likeness and his image. So our testimony keeps hope alive, not only in God, but our race and our people. What that means is, as a black person, don't put no black person down. You know, if you don't like nobody calling you nigga, don't call nobody else nigga. You know how we be out here doing, don't demean nobody, you know, because, you know, other people demean it. Uplift the people. This is how you inspire hope. You don't put hope by downgrading people and putting them down. I know, yeah, I said that word. Y'all can say N-word. You don't say N-word when you're calling them that. So just to be truth, reality. If we're going to lift each other up, be an example. If you don't want the world treating you this way, do not treat your own brother or sister that way. This is how we inspire hope. Keep our hope alive by showing the other world how we should be treated as a people. We must not hide our history from any generation or the world. Again, it's our heritage. We can't change history. Let's just embrace it, learn from it, move on. You know, let it inspire us to be greater. Why? Because we're writing history every day. We must tell it with pride so that all generations can learn and strive to build on and maintain the progress and racial reconciliation that have been made. Jesus reconciled us back to God. He saved us from sin. Now it's our responsibility to reconcile as brothers and sisters, that we would live the way God wants us to live, that we would love one another as ourselves. And see, that is the worst thing that we can do as a black people, is to march in the protest about how someone is treating us, and then we turn right back around and treat them the same way that we were treated. That's just like the hypocrisy of this nation being founded. You want to break free from slavery or England, and yet you still have slaves at home. We don't want to make that. Let's not keep those kind of things of the past. Amen? Now again, we must tell our testimony with pride, so that all generations can learn and strive to build on and maintain the progress and racial reconciliation that we have already been made. Don't go back. Let's keep going forward. Let's push our people forward by inspiring us, encouraging us, building us, pushing us, exalting us, encouraging us to keep on moving on. Again, if it had not been for the Lord on our side, again, I close with this. We remember and forget not to inspire hope. What a great way to do it. Inspire hope.
So even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day, this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day, down in Alabama, with its vicious racists, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, one day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted, and every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is a faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day when all of God's children be able to sing with new meaning, "My country, 'tis of thee. Sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. And so let freedom ring. From the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire, let freedom ring. From the mighty mountains of New York, let freedom ring. From the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania, let freedom ring. From the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado, let freedom ring. From the curvaceous slopes of California, but not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi, from every mountainside. Let freedom ring, and when this happens, when we allow freedom ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last."
Now, if that don't inspire hope, tell me what will. Let the dream live on until it becomes a reality for all America. We thank God for our testimony as Black people. We thank God for this Black History Month, that we can hear our testimony, hear our story, our heritage being told, and that we will embrace it and be proud of who we are, because we are who God has made us to be. But it all starts with Jesus Christ. We give God credit for all. He set the tone when he first set us free from sin. You know, we have to be delivered from sin. His number one objective to come to earth was to save us from sin. So salvation is always there. So there's anyone out there today that has not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today is a good day. Amen. If you have hate in your heart, if you can't love our neighbor as ourselves, if we can't love our enemies, then We need to help our Jesus to help us to get to that place. He loved us in spite of us, and we have to do the same. But if you're out there, amen, what a great time to come that we can help bring equality by loving all people the way God wants us to do. If that's you today, hey, all you got to do is come to him, repent of your sins. Amen. He will receive you. Amen. You can do your own sinners, so-called prayer. Amen. Just speak from your heart. If you come, he'll no wise cast you out, because that's the reason that he came. If you need any more us to walk with you through this process, you can reach out to us in our communications on our website or Facebook page, and we will gladly reach back out to you and, amen, help you along this walk. But we thank God for, number one, the salvation of our souls. Then as a people, we thank God for the salvation that he has brought us through as a black race here in the United States of America. Father, we thank you, God, for this day that you've given us, Lord. You brought us from a mighty long ways, and we do believe that if it had not been for you on our side, God, we know that we don't know where we would be today, but we thank you that you were on our side. The fact that we have come, the journey that we traveled, we know that you have been on our side. There have been many sacrifices, many lost, much pain and much suffering, but through it all, God, you have brought us through this journey. We thank you for all those. We honor them. We glorify them. We honor them, all that have made the sacrifice, all that have played the pivotal parts in getting us to where we are today. We thank you for them, God. We thank you for bringing us through. We pray, Father, that the dream that Dr. King is, that, you know, that this dream will come alive. We live to inspire hope that we'll still look for that dream, that the time will come when his total dream will become a reality. That is our prayer today, Father. And we know, God, that you brought us this far, and we believe that you're going to take us on. We thank you again, God. We lift up our people. We lift up all people before you today, Lord. In this time now, we all suffer, we're going through, but God, you are the savior of all. And we thank you for that. We just pray, God, that you would just keep our people as a whole encouraged, God, that we will come together as never before in this time, in this season. Let the oppression, the things that we're still suffering through, let them unite us, that we can come together as one. And then we are better together than we are alone. But again, God, we thank you for our testimony as a people in our journey. We give you praise, we give you honor and glory for all the things, Lord, that you have done. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Again, I hope that some thoughts that I shared today were just encouraged. I hope we did give us a mind to honor and give us a mind not to want to repeat the wrongs of the past as a people, and yet still inspire hope to all Black Americans for where we've come from. Our testimony is our stones of remembrance, all that we've been through. And next week, we're going to pick back up in Joshua 4, and we will look more closely into that story as well. Again, thank you for tuning in. At this time, I believe we do have another slideshow that we're going to go out with. Please pay close attention to our announcements as well. Next Sunday is the first Sunday. We will be doing our communion. And also remember, each first Sunday is the offering that we give, benevolence offering that we always send each first Sunday, $500 to the Atlanta Food Bank in helping in that effort as well. So we thank you for what you have been given and continue to do so as well. It's not next Sunday. First Lady just instructed me next Sunday, the fourth Sunday. I'm sorry. So hold that thought. And I'll repeat that again next week. But hey, if you can too, you can go ahead and pay it next week. You won't forget about it for the first Sunday. But communion is the first Sunday. Thank you again. God bless. Let us pay attention to the slide in the announcements. Thank you, baby.
Whoa, I step.
stepped in water,
uh-huh.
The water was cold,
uh-huh.
It chilled my body,
uh-huh.
But not my soul,
uh-huh.
If you don't believe,
uh-huh.
That I've been redeemed,
uh-huh.
Just follow me down,
uh-huh.
To the Jordan stream,
uh-huh.
See that Jordan river,
uh-huh.
That Jordan river,
uh-huh.
That Jordan river,
uh-huh.
The Jordan river,
uh-huh.
The water was cold,
uh-huh.
That water was cold,
uh-huh.
It chilled my body,
uh-huh.
But not my soul,
uh-huh.
Then Jordan river,
uh-huh.
The Jordan river,
uh-huh.
That Jordan river,
uh-huh.
That Jordan river, uh-huh. Oh, I came to tell you
what Jesus said.
I came to tell you
what Jesus said.
Oh, I came to tell you.